price is one of the things that makes wine so uncomfortable.
And it's sort of an oaky afterbirth.
Pinot Noir routinely tastes like it thinks it's way too good for you.
But what's the real difference in taste between cheap and expensive wine?
Sounds a little like gym sock.
First one tasted like wine I drink, so I know for sure it's not expensive.
A pretty woman's armpit.
That is delicious!
Vague hints of feminism.
That's rank. That's cheap.
I would say it's at least 4 times better.
But is it really possible to taste the difference between cheap and expensive wine? I've got 5 wines here and we're gonna put that to the test. Let's see if I can taste the difference. So what makes wine cheap and what makes wine expensive? There's a lot of factors that go into it. The very bottom line, more expensive grapes are going to equal more expensive wines. And just like real estate, that comes down to location, location, location. There's a reason California wines can be a little bit pricier than those from Spain or the south of France. I did go into greater detail on this topic in the video. Are expensive wines really for suckers? It's a reaction video. I'll throw it down in the description box below. I generally find the sweet spot for high quality wine in the US at least is the $25 to $50 range. When you're in Europe, that can go even lower. When it starts to get into $50, $100, and hundreds of thousands of dollars, the wine prices really come down to prestige, marketing, and supply and demand. But that doesn't mean you can't drink great at low prices, and I hope to prove that here today. I picked 5 wines because I wanted to make this a tad more difficult on myself. I've got 1 cheap wine, 1 expensive wine, and 3 kind of the mid-range tier. I picked GSMs because a lot of inexpensive GSMs can be very good and punch way above their price point.
You're gonna do it!
So maybe I'll get fooled by a couple of wines here. For those of you who don't know, GSM stands for Grenache Syrah Mourvèdre Blends. Although the wines don't always contain all 3 grapes, they can also contain other grapes like Cunois, Carignan, and a wide range of other varieties. While in the old world, these blends originated in the south of France and in Spain, now you can find great ones all over the world, including in South Africa, Australia, and of course, California and Washington State. Just note, in Australia and South Africa, you might see them as Grenache Shiraz Mataro. You're going to find flavors of baked strawberry, dark cherry, a little bit of smoked meat. Yes, that's what's cool, a little bit of smoked meat. I think these are great alternatives to Cabernet Sauvignon when you're eating steak or grilled meats. The factors that I'm going to be looking for in determining the prices of the wines here in this blind tasting is 1, complexity. Is there anything different besides the fruit flavors in the wine? 2, I'm going to be looking for richness. It's kind of like the difference between skim milk and whole milk. Skim milk is obviously going to be a little thinner. Whole milk is going to be a little bit richer. In GSM's case, the richer wine probably should be the more expensive one. And 3 is length. How long does that wine stay on the palate? Cheaper wines with cheaper grapes usually have a shorter finish. And it's so funny, some people actually like that. Not us wine nerds though. So let's get started. Wine 1. So wine 1 already has that baked strawberry, that a little bit of meatiness type flavor. Literally, it's fine hint of, if you ever had beef jerky when you were a kid, I was addicted to beef jerky. That's what you're gonna get in GSMs. Or maybe even a little bit of soy sauce to go along with that fruit. Wine 2. Wine 2 is a little bit funky. I grew up on a farm. If I went into an old dusty barn, that's what you get sometimes with these wines. A little bit funky on the nose, but the palate is quite juicy, quite fruity, and it has some length. Not bad, not bad. Wine 3. Wine 3 definitely smells the biggest out of all of them. It's more intense, which leads me to believe right away, maybe it's the more expensive wine. Wine 3 definitely has more licorice notes, more intense, more full-bodied, and the length. The length between the first 2 wines and this, the length, it's just much, much longer. It's staying in the palate. The tannins, the stuff that makes your mouth dry, really gripping the palate. I think it might be the most expensive. We'll see, though. Wine 4. It's really funny. If you're a beef jerky nut or you were into smoked or preserved meats, GSMs really can have that kind of aroma. Black olive even, black cherry, baked strawberry type notes in 4. 4 even has the richness and the complexity, maybe even to be the most expensive. Wow. Wine 5. Wine 5 is a little fruitier, a little more simpler. It doesn't have the complexity, so right away I'm thinking, oh, maybe it's the cheapest. Not bad, not bad. Okay, I have what I think is the cheapest, most expensive. I have to say, between all five wines, the two that really stood out is the one I believe to be the most expensive, and then the mid-range price wine, which I thought was of the highest quality. It even tastes like expensive wine. Those are the two that stood out. But this tasting really confirmed what I thought about GSM blends. You can have a lot of value at the low end. Let's do the reveal, shall we? Number five is what I thought was the cheapest wine. The length on this wine was quite good. The body was quite good, but it was just a little bit less rich, a little bit less complex, and a little bit more fruity than all the other wines. Depending on this price, I think this wine is really good value, especially if it's the cheapest. Let's see if I got it right. So, number five, it is the Vignerons Catalans Côte du Roussillon Village Lesquerde from Racine, 2018. Languedoc Roussillon in the south of France, a source of fantastic wines, high value for money. This is made by a cooperative, $8. Like I said, this is a very good wine at that price point. Not too shabby. Now I have the three mid-range wines. These are wines that fall in the $12 to $19 range. I'm going to go from cheapest to most expensive in that price point. So the cheapest mid-range wine that I thought was wine number two. It was the wine earlier that said it was a little bit funky. Actually, it turned me off quite a bit in terms of the nose, but the palate brought me back because there were some nice complexities there. Let's see what this is, shall we? This is the Château Veyran, Casse de la Olivette, from Saint-Chinian. This is a region in the Languedoc. $12. So I guess I actually got that one right. I'm two for two. Cross my fingers. Let's see the next three. Okay, the next wine number one, I thought was also mid-range wine. I thought was not as it was very good. Really a good start to the tasting. Let's see what it is. This is the Château du Prieuré de Mourgues. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. Also from Saint-Chinian, 2017, $16. I think this is very good for the money. Syrah, Grenache, Mourvèdre. Nice. GSM to the T. All right, the two that now here's the thing. Wine number four, which I thought was the most expensive in the mid-range bunch. This wine acts to me more like a $30 wine. So this is something that I would highly seek out. I thought it was very good. Length, everything. I mean, it was better than the other cheaper wines. It wasn't better than the expensive wine, but it was very good. I was really impressed with it. Let's see. This is the Vignoble Bello Mouleré. Saint-Chinian, 2019. Syrah Grenache and Mourvèdre. So more Syrah in this. This is $17. This is something I highly recommend. This was really, really, really good. You like some of those dark fruit flavors. You like bigger wine, full body wine. You want a little bit of tannin. This was really complex. Really, really liked it. So it looks like I got all the wine. The most expensive wine in the bunch here. Yes, let's see. Oh, that makes sense. This is a Domaine du Grand Tinel Châteauneuf-du-Pape, 2016. I think I had this vintage maybe a year or two ago. Châteauneuf-du-Pape's are some of the most famous Grenache Syrah Mourvèdre GSM blends in the world, in the south of France. Really nice wine. What set this apart from all the other wines was the richness. It was so full, and then the length. It was the longest lasting out of all five wines. When you're tasting, sometimes you have good days, sometimes you have bad days. Today for me, luckily, was a good day, but that's not always the case. I've been to a lot of tastings before where I've been fooled, or a lot of tastings where inexpensive wines did better than the more expensive wines. But in general, I think if you have some experience, you focus, you concentrate, you can pick out the differences. Not, you don't even have to be a wine expert. It's like anybody that enjoys food or enjoys flavors knows the difference between a high quality dish and a lower quality dish. And I think the same thing applies to wine as well. And just because wine is a little bit more expensive doesn't mean that you have to enjoy it. This $8 wine, I'd be so happy to have at a barbecue outside, a little bit chilled. The Châteauneuf-du-Pape was a bit better wine, but it's a bigger wine, something to have on a cold day. You know, it's the summer right now, maybe not something I would want to drink as well. Probably the one that I really was impressed with was the Vignoble Bello. This was really good. So I'd love to know what you think about cheap versus expensive wines. Have you ever did a taste test like this, any experiments? Drop it in the comments below. And if you like this video, please subscribe to the YouTube channel Exotic Wine Travel. Ring the bell so you know when new videos are out. And if you're thinking about what to watch next, I'll throw it up right there. Thanks a lot. Cheers.